In our sundown perambulations of late, through the outer parts of Brooklyn, we have observed several parties of youngsters playing bass, a certain game of ball. Let us go forth a while and get better air in our lungs. Let us leave our close rooms. The game of ball is glorious. Walt Whitman.
Two strikes, ball one. Here comes the pitch. Strike three. A no-hitter, a perfect game for John Morrison.
I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth. That I might have been given a bad break, but I've got an awful lot to look for. Thank you.
Back of throws. There's a long back. It's going to be, I believe. The Giants won the pennant. 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 Bobby Thompson hits into the mid deck of the left field stand. The Giants won the pennant. And they're going crazy. They're going crazy.
So the story goes that a Union Army general named Abner Doubleday sat down and invented the game of baseball in Cooperstown, New York, back in 1839. Now, despite the fact that military records show that Doubleday wasn't even in Cooperstown in 1839, and although he published several books and left behind a stockpile of papers and correspondence in which he never once mentions the game, if you ask any average fan, who invented baseball? They'll reply, Abner Doubleday, of course. So be it. Despite the fact that the game evolved from such 19th century games as rounders, two-a-cat, and town ball is beside the point. For baseball fans, like religious fanatics, put faith and belief over cold hard facts. Just ask any Cleveland Indians fan. Welcome once again to KC's Musical Dustbin. 60 minutes of the best in folk, rock, blues, jazz, country, and our favorite category, miscellaneous. Remember, all we ask is that you keep an open mind, a very dangerous thing. The subject today, obviously, baseball. So grab a hot dog and a nice cold beer, and let the games begin on Casey's Musical Dustbin.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remove your caps and stand for the singing of our national anthem.
In the second inning, walked and scored. He's sitting on 714. Here's the pitch by Downing. Swinging. There's a drive into left center field. That ball is going to be out of here. It's gone. It's 715. There's a new home run champion of all time, and it's Henry Aaron. The fireworks are going. Henry Aaron is coming around third. His teammates are at home plate, and listen to this crowd.
Move over, babe. Here comes Henry, and he's swinging me. difference between hitting 250 and 300 is? It's 25 hits. 25 hits and 500 at-bats is 50 points, okay? There's 6 months in a season, that's about 25 weeks. That means if you get just one extra flare a week, just one, a gork, you get a ground ball, you get a ground ball with eyes, you get a dying quail, just one more dying quail a week, and you're in Yankee Stadium.
There's an occasional thrill, or a Nels, or a Hojo, but it's not like in days of yore. What's wrong with today's baseball players? Why don't they have great nicknames anymore? Some bullets and a pistol Pete in the game. But my favorite one of all was the Hondo Hurricane. Ducky, Lucky, and Harry the Hat. Snuffy and Stuffy and Harry the Cat. Dizzy and Daffy and a wild horse they never tame. I never will forget that Hondo Hurricane. Aki, Indiana, Texan, the mechanical man. Every loop was sweet, and Tom was terrific, and Musial was the man. King Carl Hubble, the Fordham Flash. Teddy Ball Game and Cotton Nash. There was Big and Little Poison, why they gave you aches. There was King Kong Keller and the Hondo Hurricane. Peanuts, Lowry, and Jordan Joe. Silly and Gibby, and Walter was a great big train. But my favorite one of all was the Hondo Hurricane. Pinky, Stinky, Slats and Stick. Andy was handy, and Mantle was the Mick. Louisiana Lightning and Fire threw some flames. Putzi Caballero and the Hondo Hurricane. The games were short, but the stories were mighty tall. And if you didn't have a nickname to call your own, you didn't have a name at all. Like Kaka Kyler and Des Evans, the peerless leader was old Frank Chance. There were rifles and bullets and a pistol Pete in the game. In a shotgun Shuba and the Hondo Hurricane. Charlie, Charlie, Happy Felch, Sam, Sam Jones and a Ding Dong Bell. Step, 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 step.
There you go, music from Terry Cashman, Hondo Hurricane. Terry Cashman was the late Jim Croce's longtime record producer, and Terry Cashman recorded and released dozens of baseball recordings through the years. We'll hear more from him coming a bit later in the show. Out of that, Move Over Babe, here comes Henry. Very interesting history to this song. It was done by a guy named Billy Slayback. Now, Billy Slayback was a former major league pitcher, mediocre at best. He pitched for a couple years for the Detroit Tigers. And back in 1973, after he was retired, when Hank Aaron was chasing Babe Ruth for the all-time home run record, he wrote this song with legendary Tiger broadcaster Ernie Harwell. Now, Harwell wrote the lyrics. Slayback wrote all the music and recorded all the vocals and instruments as well. Good tune. Move Over Babe from Billy Slayback. On top of that, had Cheap Seats from Alabama and Center Field with John Fogerty. Definitely a classic. It's Casey's Musical Dustbin. You're enjoying the fact, I hope, that we're celebrating baseball on this episode as we're back in the swing of the great American pastime. And you couldn't celebrate baseball unless you had a couple cold ones, you know what I'm saying? So grab a chair there, and I'll get you a cold Stroh's. How's that sound? You ready? You want one? 16-ouncer or 12-ouncer? All right, here we go. All right. Sounds good. Bottoms up. Whew. Hits the spot, doesn't it? Getting back to the music, we're going to do something a bit different on the Dustbin. We're going to pay homage to three of the least successful franchises in baseball history. Most shows would honor teams like the Yankees or the Cardinals or the Dodgers, the best teams in baseball history. We're going the opposite way with three of the most hapless franchises, including the Chicago Cubs, the Cleveland Indians, and the old St. Louis Browns on Casey's Musical Dustbin.
St. Louis Browns. I got the St. Louis Browns. Since the St. Louis Browns left town. Since the St. Louis Browns left town. Who were the St. Louis Browns? Tell us what you found. The St. Louis Browns were a baseball team, and they lost more than the Mets could ever dream. They had a one-armed man in left field named Pete Gray, 44. There's no healthy men around to play baseball, then they's all away fighting in a war. Bill Vett came along as general manager along about 47. He hired a man to play for them. He stood about 4'11". I got the St. Louis Browns. I got the St. Louis Browns. Since the St. Louis Browns left town. Since the St. Louis Browns left town. The St. Louis Browns. Tell us what you found. The St. Louis Browns were a baseball team, and they lost more than the Mets could ever dream. Ah, St. Louis had a hitter. Roy Sievers was his name. And in that team's dismal history, he hit many homers in many games. They had a no-hit pitcher. They pitched a real humdinger. But Bob Turley got too surly, and they traded him too early. I got the St. Louis Browns. I got the St. Louis Browns. Since the St. Browns left town. Since the St. Louis Browns left town. Who were the St. Louis Browns? Tell us what you found. they always have the damnedest luck. Now many a Missouri boy, how he loved those dangerous cars, but he never loved the lonely Browns, although they tried so hard. Meanwhile, folks in Baltimore, they wanted a baseball team, so they called St. Louis up and said, "You think the Browns can leave town and become part of our Baltimore dream?" Well, you know what happened. The Baltimore Orioles became a real winning club, and in the hearts of all teenage boys everywhere, who are now in their 30s and 40s, well, sometimes they look at their falling out hair. They remember when they had the St. Louis Browns. Had the St. Louis Browns. Since the St. Louis Browns left town. Since the St. Louis Browns left town. Who were the St.
It's cool, it's overcast, and it's foggy on opening day here in Cleveland.
Entire world.
Oh, look. This is Charlie Donovan with the Cleveland Indians.
How would you like to manage the Indians this year?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? This is a chance to manage in the big leagues.
Let me think it over, will you, Charlie? I got a guy on the other line about some white walls. I'll talk to you later.
So the Tribe drops its third straight on this trip, 6-1 to the Rangers. For the Indians, one run on, let's see, one hit. That's all we got, one goddamn hit.
You can't say goddamn on the air.
Don't worry, nobody's listening anyway.
The game was tied in the bottom of the 12th when Charlie Hustle rounded third looking to score on a Jim Hickman single. And suddenly, Ray Fosse was all that stood between Rose and a National League win.
That triple play, the year the Tribe were champions of the game. The Gray Eagle soared to the peaks, Smith and Bagby ended the streak. Things were great in 48 when Woodrow had the reins. I'm talking baseball. Julius Joe and Kovaleski, Cleveland baseball. Trotsky, Dale Narleski, Averill, Rabbit Robin, Columbine. When Bearden took the Sox, he gave us pride. Talking baseball and the Tribe. Senor Lopez gave the orders, and from south of the border, Avila came to take the batting crown. Roger Maris, what a pity, gone off to Kansas City. But Rocky was knocking them out all over American League towns. And talking baseball, Lemon, Win, and Tito. Cleveland baseball, Dobie Calavito, the Indians had Rosen on their side, John Romano and Tion kicking high. I'm talking baseball and the Tribe. Talking Cleveland Indian baseball, Satchel and Sutton Sam. Calavito's four in just one game. Herbie scored. What a shame. Barker, 27 in a row. Come back, Joe Charbonneau. Well, John Denny set the tone. He told the Yankees where to go. He'd rather be in Cleveland after all. New names join the old. Another team unfolds. This is the year for Davey Garcia, so let's play ball. I'm talking baseball. Delone and Denny, Cleveland baseball. Hargrove, Bacon, Lenny, Toby, Rick, Dibzinski, and why can Thornton find out?
baseball man to try.
Don't knock the rock, the rock.
I'm talking baseball. Cleveland's got to try.
Don't knock the rock, the rock.
I'm a fella to throw the ball.
Don't knock
right through
the rock, the rock.
I'm talking baseball. Cleveland.
Don't knock.
Len Barker on the verge of really one of the great games in baseball history.
This place is bedlam, Herb. It is absolutely pandemonium here at the stadium.
Ernie Witt stands in. Wind up. Here it comes. Fly ball center field. Manning coming on. He's there. He catches it. Len Barker has pitched the no-hitter. A perfect game for Len Barker.
Two balls, one strike. A high fly ball, deep center field, way back. That's going to be in the Indian bullpen. The game is over. Manny Ramirez with a three-run home run. And for the second time this year, the Indians have beaten Troy Percival in the ninth inning.
The set by Perez, the pitch. Swung on, hit hard, hit deep to right. This ball, gone! A bombing at home plate on a walk-off grand slam by Travis Hafner.
Welcome once again to KC's Musical Dustbin as we celebrate the great game of baseball. We wrapped up our tribute to some of the least successful teams in Major League history with the late, great Steve Goodman and a dying Cub fan's last request. Ahead of that, we had a terrible song, Cleveland Indians fans. It's a bad song, but it's a piece of history called Go Joe Charbonneau. It was recorded by a Cleveland punk band in 1980. That was the year that Joe Charbonneau had his big Rookie of the Year season in Cleveland. Of course, he faded back into the minors the next year, but we'll take what we can get, right? The only redeeming part of that tune is Herb Scores play-by-play on that. And we had Talking Tribe by Terry Cashman before that in the late 70s. Terry Cashman wrote a song called Willie, Mickey, and the Duke, Talking Baseball, and that was kind of a tribute to those three great New York outfielders. It got some airplay on AM Sports Radio as a result. He wanted to capitalize on that, and he recorded 26 separate songs for each major league team, celebrating their history. Myself and five other people in Cleveland bought Talkin' Tribe Baseball by Terry Cashman that year. I think that was back in 1982. So there you go, and we got it started with a former member of the Birds, Skip Batten, and the St. Louis Browns. That's going to wrap up Casey's Musical Dustbin. And way back on June 19, 1846, the New York Baseball Club defeated the Hoboken Knickerbockers 23-1 in what is believed to be the first officially recorded baseball game. Now, it is said that that afternoon, all the players wore knickers, and 167 years later, they're still wearing them today. Is this a great game or what? We'll see you next time on Casey's Musical Dustbin.
Take me out to the ball game.
I feel bad about losing a ball game like that. There's no way you should lose that ball game, and that just doesn't make sense.
What's your opinion of Kingman's performance?
What's my opinion of Kingman's performance? What the f*** you think is my opinion of it? I think it was put that in. I don't opinion of his performance. He beat us with three home runs. What the f*** do you mean? What is my opinion of his performance? How could you ask me a question like that? What is my opinion of his performance? He hit three home runs. I'm f***ed off to lose the f***ing game. And you ask me my opinion of his performance. I mean, that's a tough question to ask me, isn't it? What is my opinion of his performance?
Yes, it is.
Ask it, and you gave me an answer.
Well, I didn't give you a good answer because I'm mad, but I mean...
That wasn't a good question.
That's a tough question to ask me right now. What is my opinion of his performance? I mean, you want me to tell you what my opinion of his performance is?
You just did.
That's right. Guy hits three home runs against us.